Welcome to Love CFI, a place where love is overflowing, where Jesus Christ is ever present to share his love with you. I'm so glad you decided to tune into our broadcast today to celebrate with us the love of Jesus Christ. I'm Pastor Ivan Stinson, and I would like to invite you to tune in every Sunday at 12 noon on Facebook Live and invite a friend. We believe that love is the key that unlocks all doors. So join us as we share love with one another. And remember that I love you and there's absolutely nothing you can do about it.
Hi, everyone. It's offering time. We believe here at Love CFI that God delights in our generosity. In 2 Corinthians 9 and 7, the Bible says that God loves a cheerful giver. It also says in verse 10 that he will multiply your seed sown. So take this opportunity to express your love by returning to him your tithes, gifts, and offerings. He said not to give grudgingly or of necessity, but that we should give with a cheerful heart. You may celebrate God with your tithes, gifts, and offerings by going to lovecfi.com and click donate, or you may use Cash App, the $LoveCFI. Thank you all so much for your seed, your continued support, and most of all, your love. Remember, God loves a cheerful giver. You can always find a reason to pray. You should take a deep breath. You should think about it. And you can always find a reason to pray. Oh, we
have. I've had struggles and disappointment. Cast down, but I'm not destroyed. There are times I don't understand, but I believe it's turning around for me, around for me. Around for me, it's turning around for me, around for me, around for me, around for me, it's turning around for me. I can see the breaking. Around for me. Oh,
Welcome to another day that the Lord has made. In it, let us rejoice and be exceedingly glad. Let us open with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we do thank you so much for this day that you have made. Father God, in it we shall rejoice and we shall be exceedingly glad. We thank you for every opportunity, God, you allow us to come into your presence. So God, I submit and surrender myself to your will and to your way on this day. I thank you for a right now word. I'm going to say that again, a right now word for your people on today. And I pray that their ears would hear and their minds would retain, that we may all be better doers of your word, not just a hearer only. And we do it all in that glorious, that matchless, that regal, royal, and majestic name of Jesus, our soon coming King. We do pray. Amen and thank God. I don't know about you, but I thank God for our pastor, our first lady, our first family, and for each and every member of Love CFI. And even though we are experiencing some times that we never, ever envisioned we would have to deal with, we're having to deal with them right now. So God has just been dealing with me all week on this one simple challenge, or a directive, I would say. So my subject for today is never, ever bench press alone. I'm going to say that again. Never, ever bench press alone. Now, see, I know Pastor works out. I know a lot of you may not work out, but you know what a bench press is. That someone that's working to build their upper body strength, get stronger, they'll lay on a bench, lay this way, and it has two rails, landing points above it. And you have a barbell with weights on the end of it. And so the person is laying down on the back. You grab your hands on the barbell and you push it up. And then you pull it out the rack and you bring it down and you go to push it back up. But the thing is, you should never, ever bench press alone. You always should have a spotter with you. Well, Brother Arthur, what do you mean? What's a spotter? Well, that's the person that's standing behind you. In the event that your muscles and your arms can't push that weight back up, and you're looking at this weight coming back down toward your neck and your chest, and you say, God, I'm pushing, but I can't make it. I'm falling, and I can't get up. But that spotter, hallelujah, is right there to grab those weights and help you get up back safely into that resting place. So we should never, ever bench press alone. Well, Brother Arthur, I don't lift weights. Well, do you walk? The safety instructors always tell us, the police, you should never, ever walk or jog alone, for their safety in numbers. Well, show that to me in the Bible. I'm so glad you asked. And when we think about the first man, Adam, God created Adam. He gave Adam a job. That's another whole message for today's mentality. He gave him a job. He gave him something to do, to tend the garden, to name every animal in creation, to have dominion and an authority over the environment. Then God saw that Adam, he was faithful in tending the garden, in naming the element, the animals, and naming the things in the earth. And God said, it's not good for man to be alone. So one night when Adam went to sleep, God said, I got to help my brother out. He pulled a rib from his side. He didn't have anesthesia, but he pulled a rib from his side, and he created Eve to be a help meet to Adam. Well, that's nice for the couple, but what about for a man? Well, he used Peter and John. He used Paul and Silas in a jail cell. He said that he sent the disciples out, not one by one, but two by two. Why? Because there is safety in numbers. So as we think about society today, there is safety in numbers. What kind of relationship are you in? Are you in it for what you can get out of it? Are you in it for what you can give into it? I would encourage you to give every opportunity that God provides for you to give and pour into somebody else's life. If you're not on the bench press or the weight stand trying to bench press, you need to be the spotter for the person that was spotting you. What do you mean? How does that look? Well, you trade places. As someone else has been there for you, you should be there for somebody else. And let them know that they are not fighting this thing called life by themselves. And it's not restricted to your blood brothers and sisters. A lot of you may know that I'm the only child. But I understand how critical it is to have brothers and sisters that have your back, and you in turn have their back, that you are concerned when they don't feel well. You're concerned when they're having crazy thoughts. You're concerned when there's something facing them and they don't know how to deal with it. But because you have been there, you're picking those weights up off of that barbell when they say, I can't push anymore. Say, I got you, my brother. Come on, let me help you. Let's push together. Let's get it on up there. See, it's good. It's okay to have a towel. But see, the towel is not to throw in. And I'll bring you back to that in a minute. I got my towel because I understand when God gets to flowing in my life, the evidence that I'm in the right place, you all will see it. It comes this way. It's coming from the crown of my head going down to the hem of my garment. It's called an anointing. It's called sweat. And I have my own towel to wipe my own sweat. I'm not throwing it in, but I'm going to continue to fight because the Bible says that the race of life is not given to the swift, nor the battle to the strong, but to those that hold on and endure until the end. So what kind of partnership are you in? What kind of friendship are you in? Are you striving to give and see how much you can give? Or are you striving to see how much you can get? It's nothing wrong with getting, but you got to get. It's like my hand. I've got my money in my hand. And as long as I have it in my hand, I got it. I got it in my hand. Nothing. I'm not going to lose it because I have my hand closed. But by the same token, I cannot receive anything into my hand. It has to be open to receive. Here's what I'm saying. Open your hand. Be a blessing. Be someone else's spotter. Be their accountability partner. Who are you accountable to? When you have things that you don't know or understand, who do you turn to? Who do you call? Who do you go to? My brothers, I encourage you to have someone in your circle that you can confide in. I am thankful that I was introduced to an organization about 5 years ago called the Christian Businessmen's Connection. And what I found as a foundational piece that makes so much sense, we say that isolation is dangerous. It's not good for you to just be isolated by yourself like you're on an island and no one else is on your island. God did not create us to be an island. He created us to be a community concerned about our brothers and our sisters. So if we look even in Ecclesiastes chapter 4, verses 9 through 11, and it talks about two are better than one because they have a good reward for their labor. For if they fall, somebody else is there to help pick them back up. But woe unto those who don't have, when you fall, you don't have anybody else to help you up. That ain't right. That's not a good place. You need somebody to help you when you've fallen and you can't get up. When you're down, you need somebody you can call to help pick you back up. Even if it's just spiritually hearing something good in your ear. But it says again, if one lies down and they have no one to pick them up, that's not a good place to be. So the spotter is also your encourager. Who's encouraging you? Or better yet, who are you encouraging? You know, you've gone through some stuff. You've had people to say stuff about you that was not true, and you felt some kind of way. I know I have, but I thank God that I did not stay in that place of being upset and mad for a long time. Somebody said, you got to get over it. As we do these things and we take that towel and we're reminded, I can't throw it in, but I've got to allow this to be my life link. You know, there was a TV game show called Life Link, a lifeline, where they would ask you a question. And if you didn't know the answer, they would give you a lifeline. You could call and ask someone to help you with the answer. Life is the same way. We need people in our life that we can call in a time of need. The Bible says that a friend is a very present help in a time of need. So whether you are in a need or someone you know may be in a need, and we want to understand that God has allowed us to go through these things. And then even in Ecclesiastes, it talks about that I have observed an example of meaningless in our world, and it's the case of a person being alone. And it's not, you can't gain anything from that. But when we understand that God put us here for each other, that I am my brother and my sister's keeper. When I got married, I'm my wife's keeper and she's my helper. And then sometimes I'm her helper and she's my keeper. Because you all know I don't cook, but thank God she does. Woo! Thank you, sweetie. I love my wife because we partner in together to do life together. I'm not just my way or no way. No, I lean to her wisdom on some things that's her area of expertise. And by the same token, she does the same thing for me. Why? Because we are partnered together. And we are not bench pressing alone. We are out working and walking and doing life together. Now, as we talk about this weather thing, see, here's another thing. If we didn't have heat, or sometimes like we may turn the heat down in the house and we are cold. But when you get into bed and you have another warm body next to you, your husband or your wife, you don't stay cold as long. Why? Because you have somebody you're connected with. That's what life should be about. We're all working towards something. We're working whether it's to leave a legacy, which should be important. We are working to set an example for those coming behind us. We're working to help somebody else to find their way, to say, look, I've been down this thing of life a little while, and I want to help you avoid some pitfalls. I want to help you in this gym. You want to be physically fit. You need to have a six pack. Well, that's wonderful. But sometimes life takes over and our six goes to a 12 or a 12 to a 24. And we're no longer good looking physically, but our spirit should be much stronger because we have had a coach to help us go back through life. As we think about all of these things, and we think about life itself, it is so much better to look back and say, I thank God for my journey, my struggles. They didn't destroy me. They made me stronger. I thank God for learning how to discern who was for me and who was against me. And let that be a life point, that we don't get stuck, but we use it as a stepping stone, as an advancement. As we look back over our life and we think things over, we can truly say that we have been blessed, for we do have a testimony. And then I'm going to close with this, Philippians chapter 3, verses 12 and 4 through 14. I don't mean to say that I have already reached perfection, but I keep working towards that day when I will finally be all that Christ has saved me for and wants me to be. No, my dear brothers and sisters, I am still not all I should be. But I am focusing on all of my energies on this one thing. I am forgetting the past. I'm looking forward to see what lies ahead. I strain to reach the end of my race and receive the prize for which God has called through Christ Jesus is calling me for. My brother, my sister, remember this. You are not alone. Just keep pressing on with your spot as the spot or the spotter in life, because I need you and you need me to survive. That was a song, and even all of this week, it just resonated in my spirit, and I had to Google it and look it up. It came out in 2002, but I believe it is a right now song to remind us of where we are, and it's by Hezekiah Walker, and he says, I need you to survive. I won't harm you with words from my mouth because I love you. And I need you to survive. I'll pray for you. You pray for me. I need you to survive. I won't harm you with words from my mouth. I love you. I need you to survive. So remember, it's good to have a towel in your hand, but it's not to throw it in and throw it away. It's to wipe the sweat as we keep walking and working our faith. Work your faith to life, not to death. Be alive to those that you encounter. Be a witness to somebody else to let them know that earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal, that God knows the plans that he has for you. Plans for a hope and a future. Plans not to harm you, but plans to use you to be a spotter and a coach in somebody else's life. Why? Because you should never, ever bench press alone. God bless you. Whew. I pray God ministered to you through that word. And if you have not, first of all, open the door of your heart and invite Christ to come in, I would encourage you to do that right now. In fact, I'm going to help you. Pray this simple prayer. Dear God, I come to you as humbly as I know how. God, I realize that I have messed up in life. I've made some bad decisions. I've had some bad friends. But God, right now, I open the door of my heart and I invite you to come in and take up residence and allow me to sit at your right hand. That my days, the remainder of my days, will be better than my past. I receive you as my Lord and as my Savior in Jesus' name. And now, if you don't have a church home, you need a good church home. And I can tell you without question, Love CFI is a good place to be planted, to be ministered to be taught the word of God by our pastor, Ivan Stinson, our first lady, Cynthia Stinson, and the other ministers. We are not in the building right now, but you can go to lovecfi.com and say, I want to be a member. I want to be a part of a church that loves God, that's demonstrating the love of God in their name and in their actions. Our physical building is 9671 Thomas Road in Jonesboro, Georgia. We will be back soon and very soon. We are believing God. But until then, don't allow our distance to cause you not to join us. We love you. We are concerned about you and your future. So join us here at Love CFI. And I can prophetically say your days will never, ever be the same. We love you. We look forward to seeing you and you joining us here at Love CFI.